It's the Andy Thompson Show on ESPN 97.7.
Sports, 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 sports.
Skeeter Peters on the Andy Thompson Show.
What a wholesome moment. Frozone and Mr. Incredible, other known as my dad and Lucas' dad, sharing an embrace, you know, just watching their sons and their team do well. You know, they've sacrificed a lot in order for us to be here. So shout out to them, especially on this Father's Day, man.
All right, Sport Hole, what do you got for a Skeeter Beater tonight, buddy?
Well, it's game five. You're going back to the parquet of the TD Ameritrade Boston Garden Fleet Center.com Arena. And Boston's favored by 6.5. And my opinion on this series is the same opinion I had on the previous Western Conference series when Minnesota, who I hyped up and was freaking out about, went down 3-0. At that point, you don't have a right to smile. You don't have a right to act tough. In press conferences, talking about the mentality you're going to have going forward, I don't want to hear from you. I don't want to see you until a game seven. So it's game five tonight. We got it for you on ESPN 97.7. But I don't give a crap about Kyrie or Luka. You've let us all down. You're a shame to the Western Conference. You played 82 games. You can't go to the finals. You can't go to the championship series and flop, especially with two of the best players in the league on the same team. That's exactly what they did. And I know that they won game four, and they put it on them in game four, Larry. I didn't see a lot of that game. I will be watching tonight's game because I'm taking the Celtics -6.5, Larry. I think the drum roll is supposed to go before the pick there, but I think they'll put them away. I was watching some stuff on Joe Mazzulla today, and I like Joe Mazzulla. And I think I like him because he reminds me of like a, he's like a wrestler. He's like a scrappy, small wrestler, underdog, was coaching Division II basketball, got into a film room and made his way up, had some fortuitous things happen to get the head coaching job with Udoka getting Me Too'd, and was considered for the Jazz job before Will Hardy took it. But I like Mazzulla because of that. He's a unique style coach in the NBA, and I think people appreciate, even though last year they were killing him because he never knew when to call a timeout, this year they're winning. They're going to win the NBA Finals. He's going to get a ring with this group. And I think the players respect his style because of how he is. Here's him talking a few days ago about Jerry West. So Mazzulla is a high school star guard, goes to West Virginia, coached by Bob Huggins. Goes to the NIT his first year, goes to the NCAA tournament his second year, and has that big upset against Duke. You remember that, Larry?
Yes.
And then his next year, he gets arrested. He has an assault charge at a bar or something in Morgantown, and this is him talking about Jerry West's influence on his career shortly after West passes away. Mazzulla's asked about this.
My junior year in college wasn't living up to anyone's standards. And I get a call, and it's Jerry. And a lot of explicatives, but essentially told me that I was an F-up and was ruining an opportunity to be great at something, and just, you know, just let me have it for like 10, 15 minutes. And I thought it was one of the most impactful phone calls that I had really in my life. And stayed at his house once and overslept for UCLA open gym and went down for breakfast and got another ass chewing because I wasn't being competitive enough. And so, you know, I think I remember about him is like he had a tough way of showing that he loved you, but he was super, super competitive and he really, really cared about you. And he showed it in a way that like kind of spoke to my language. So he'll be missed, and praying for the family.
So that was a nice little insight on his connection with Jerry West last week. Take Boston, Larry. -6.5 at home. Speaking of Boston, I watched for the second time, the Celtics-Lakers 30-for-30 over the weekend. And it's so good and so long. There's so much history. Here's the one little observation I wanted to make about it, though, Larry, is those two franchises we're like the only two teams in the league for like 30 years. Every offseason, it was like, okay, the Lakers knew they needed to get better, so they brought in Wilt Chamberlain. And then the next year, or the next 5 years later, they knew they needed to challenge the Celtics, so they brought in Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And then the next year's, oh, they had the number one pick again. They get Magic Johnson, and the Celtics get Bird. And then they go and get Bill Walton in the offseason. And then the year after that, they have the Celtics have the number one pick again. Red Auerbach fleeced some other NBA teams to get another number one pick. They pick Len Bias, the best player in college basketball. So it was this weird, and there's more, if I could think of them. It was this amazing thing where every offseason, those two teams were just bringing in the best players, either through the draft. I don't know how they had all those great draft picks every year, or through free agency. So Red Auerbach deserves all of the credit he gets, and so does Jerry Buss. And then that continued, obviously, through, you know, with the Lakers always getting all these free agents and stuff like that. But it was an amazing documentary. And, you know, Larry Bird stuck out to me, Lawrence, because there was that thing with Isaiah, and Isaiah saying he'd just be another player if he was black. And they had a press conference about it, and Larry Bird was just like, hey, I'm over it. I don't care at all that he said that. He's sitting right next to Isaiah, and Larry's sitting there making jokes, laughing with the media, like, why are you guys making this such a big deal? If it doesn't matter to me, it shouldn't matter to you. And he made a great example. He was a great example of how to handle dumb stuff. And I think right now, Caitlin Clark is similarly handling storylines with race and with people diminishing what she's done and stuff like that with great aplomb, Larry. Great aplomb. That's our word of the day. All right, let's go to Katie for our first hour look at the National News Desk. Katie, what do you got, Katie? Do we have Katie Lawrence?
Yes.
Oh, there she is. Sorry, Katie. You ready? All right.
Thanks, guys. This show reminds me of college. I slept through most of it. From the Sport Hole National News Center on Bluff Street, I'm KB Rosen. Wes Miles is suing LSU over vacated wins, which drop him below the Hall of Fame threshold. The Hall of Fame has said, quote, oh, yeah, you're right, Les. Cheating is okay now. Get your cheating butt in our Hall of Fame. Roger Goodell testifies that Sunday Ticket is a premium product in court while he's being sued for charging too much for the service. It's not my fault you losers are poor. Quarterback Dia Bell, the number 9 prospect in the 2026 ESPN 300, has committed to Texas. Why not, Bell said. I just got to beat out that mouth breather with the beer belly, right? Today's Sport Hole National News is brought to you by Lawrence's mom. From the Sport Hole National News Center on Bluff Street, I'm Katie Rosen, ESPN 97.7.
Sports.
2 minute drill.
1-0 delivery.
Hammered down the line in right field, and it is fair and slides into third for an RBI triple.
Presented by Ideal Home and Auto Paint.
Let's do it. Ideal Home and Auto Paint. Helping us bring you the program today. What do you got, Sambo? On a Monday, my friends.
Sporty, what are you thinking about Utah Tech football in the upcoming season?
Well, it's hard to know what to think. I'm excited for Utah Tech football because of the new, you know, Coach Lance Anderson, his first year. I was bummed out when Coach Peterson was, you know, however they put it, he's still with the athletic department, but he's moved on from not being the coach anymore. I was bummed about that. I was thrilled with their hire with Lance Anderson. And we're thrilled to have him coming in this week. We're going to do a football story, Larry, with Lance Anderson, who has an incredible football journey and resume. And so I think Utah Tech football fans should be very excited about the upcoming year for Utah Tech because of some of the stuff that he's doing and some of the guys he's brought in. We've talked about the Syracuse quarterback. We talked about the new Iowa quarterback that they brought in through the transfer portal, the UMass tight end, Reggie Graff, the local kid, also in the quarterback room, Jaron Polu, and some other local kids. So I'm excited about that. What I don't understand is the future of the UAC. Stephen F. Austin is leaving the UAC, and there's rumors that other teams will be leaving as well. So this is from Stephen F. Austin. Stephen F. Austin University's Department of Athletics has accepted an invitation to join the Southland Conference as a full-time member effective July 1st. This came out, like, you know, a few weeks ago. We are in a dynamic new era of college athletics, said Michael McBroom, SFA's Director of Athletics. We need stability, but also bold and strategic thinking to ensure a bright future for SFA. Basically, we need to screw over the UAC and leave, not next year, but this year. So the UAC has had to scramble to reassemble their schedules because Stephen F. Austin isn't available to play in their league anymore. And apparently they paid the exit fee, which was a couple million dollars, to go out and get back into the Southland Conference and play all these Texas schools. So, and who knows if Tarleton State and some of these other Texas schools are going to leave too. Abilene Christian, I think they probably will. And I guess my thought on this, Larry, is that the idea that the WAC was going to assemble a football-only conference and try to all jump. Remember a couple years ago when this story came out, talking to Ken Beezer and talking to, we were talking to the Tarleton president on air and the big vision they had to go to the FBS. And it was crazy. Like, what? Utah Tech's going to go to the FBS? They just barely became Division I. But that, I think, was their one shot at stability with the UAC, was to all 10 schools jump at the same time to the FBS. They bring in Oliver Luck to be the commissioner and help facilitate that. It became clear that that wasn't going to be feasible in the near future. And now it's probably going to disintegrate. And where the heck is Utah Tech going to go if that happens? Where is SU going to go if that happens? I hope Utah Tech, if it does happen, finds a home in the Big Sky. And SUU's probably like, why the heck did we leave the Big Sky for this conference that is unstable? So hopefully we can get some more information about that going forward. But for the season coming up, excited to see some of these new transfer players and see Coach Anderson in his first year. I know their defense, they're bringing, you know, they're going to change the defensive philosophy, do what he did at Stanford back when they had one of the best defenses, you know, in the country back in the 2010s. So I like what Utah Tech is doing, but they can only control what they can control. They can't control the conference realignment and the switch-ups and not having a conference and the panic and the money and the budgets and all that stuff. I'm sure it's overwhelming right now in their infancy in Division I football. So that's got to be stressful. But looking forward to talking about the upcoming year with Coach Anderson this week.
Do you likey?
Good contact.
Right below the hole goes DeChambeau, and he's pumped up.
Also to Payne Stewart. He was the reason why I went to SMU. He's the reason why I wore the cap. Pony up, that's right. go SMU. Wow. I just can't thank you guys enough for all the support this week. You guys have meant the world to me. You are the best fans in the world, and I can't thank you enough.
Mm-hmm.
Sport Hole. Who were you cheering for down the stretch at the U.S. Open?
I was cheering for Rory. It's always this thing where I kind of pick the, like at the PGA Championship last second, I jumped on DeChambeau to see if he could come back and beat Schauffele and be handed the PGA Championship trophy as the live guy. I kind of like the disruptive nature of that scene, Larry. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
This week, I was cheering for Rory down the stretch. I can't do the Bryson thing. I know that he's rehabilitated his reputation, and he's better with the fans, and he's trying to be more humble and all that stuff, and there's different, you know, he's out signing autographs and stuff, going hole to hole. But I can't cheer for DeChambeau. One, and this was Brooks Koepka's biggest thing on DeChambeau, was he takes a million years for each putt. There's nothing more annoying to me than overanalyzer. And I know it's the U.S. Open. Who cares? Get up there and hit your stupid putt. You can line it up. You can talk to your caddy for 2 seconds and then shut up and putt. Or hit your iron. I guess you talk to your caddy before your iron. The analysis, the putt, and then the big show of, oh my gosh, there's something wrong with this green because it's not me. The green did something weird because we analyzed it. You know, I had my little spreadsheet out, and then I putted and I missed it. So what happened? Must be the greens. I hate that part of golf. It's kind of like flopping in the NBA, and DeChambeau's the king of that. So I don't like that. Rory is kind of the traditional, humble-style golfer. DeChambeau is the frat boy, kind of more cocky, big, strong guy who's all into the analytics and stuff. So I was cheering for Rory, and he choked. And I felt bad for him. He hasn't won in 10 years. And then he doesn't go to the post-presser, and I don't feel bad for him anymore, Rory. You got to show up to that crap. This is the same stuff that we hammer NBA players for all the time, or NFL players who bust out before the media can get a hold of them. You got to go face the music. That was probably the biggest choke, and he's had some tough ones. That was probably the biggest, toughest loss of his career, and he's fighting as the golden boy of the PGA versus this live monster. You got to go face up to the media and answer the tough, dumb questions they're going to ask. And bailing on it is not a good look. I'm not for that, Larry.
No.
So he looked bad doing that. Here is Elizabeth Nelson from The Ringer talking about DeChambeau and how he has garnered all these fans over the last couple of years. Quote, you could tell at Valhalla, and even more so this week, that the once maximally awkward DeChambeau now seems palpably more comfortable in his skin and with his game. Continuing the trend that began in Louisville this week, Bryson behaved, as my editor observed, like he was running for president. He strutted and preened when he hit the fairway. He mugged for the cameras and made nice with the galleries. By the end of his Saturday round, he had astonishingly assembled something of his own version of Arnie's Army. What could we call them? Bryson's buddies? DeChambeau's disciples? Yeah, everybody was going crazy for DeChambeau at the U.S. Open. His second win in, whatever, 4 or 5 years. I guess COVID. He won in COVID, the Open, when nobody was there. So congratulations to DeChambeau. I'm not a hater. I just was cheering for Rory. DeChambeau becomes hard for me to stomach, especially once he starts talking. So that was tough. And golf is such... What I was saying at the top of the hour, Larry, was they celebrated the grounds guy, the guy who designs the course and preps it for the major. Before they give Bryson DeChambeau his trophy, they give that guy a trophy and basically say, hey, way to go making this course impossible. It's impossible to putt. There's all this native area. There's all this wire grass. Good job. You did a great job making these guys look like idiots all weekend. And I said, I like that. I like that golf says on our biggest events, on the biggest platform, we want difficulty. We don't want super low scores and easiness. And I contrast that with a bunch of other sports who are trying to make it easier for their stars in the biggest moments. Not golf, not the USGA. Great job prepping Pinehurst number two and making it hard. And they had, and by the way, Bryson nearly choked. He missed a couple of putts. He bogeyed. He missed a huge putt late. He drove it into the bush. He had to make a shot under a tree that put him in the bunker. It's not like he was Mr. Clutch until he hit that one you just played, Larry, to set him up for the win, but he was falling apart too in the back nine, just like Rory was. Both of those guys were looking for Cantlay to win or something. So it's not like they get huge clutch points, but Bryson gets the win over Rory. Liv gets the win over PGA, and America gets the win over... it's amazing the streak that U.S. golfers have over international golfers in the biggest events right now. All right, we got Randy yet?
Yes.
All right, let's do it.
What up, buddy?
You're not very bright, are you?
Andy versus Randy.
As we do every Monday, we welcome in my twin brother Randy to give us his constructive compliments about the program. What's going on, Randy?
What up, buddy?
How are you? You doing okay?
USA! USA!
You were cheering for DeChambeau? You were the guy yelling in the gallery?
Of course.
You were cheering for that pompous frat boy?
Yeah, you were cheering for the Irishman?
I ended up cheering for Rory.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. I was cheering for Bryson. I didn't care about Liv Golf. I like Liv Golf. I don't care about that. I was cheering for the big fella. Memory of Payne Stewart, U.S. Open, came through huge. And
I mean, he nearly choked.
Rory's a little baby who can't.
Bryson.
Look,
Bryson.
The money, either take the money or shut up about
Bryson,
it.
Bryson, well, yeah, Bryson, you know, he took the cash.
You could have taken the money. You chose not to. You're jealous. And so now you're hammering these Liv guys like Bryson.
Well, I think...
And just shut up. How about you shut up and win a major? Huh? How about you make a...
He was one putt away.
To win the U.S. Open, Rory. And then...
Bryson nearly choked too, though.
And then you can, you know, pop off about how you're the Tiger Woods of this generation for the PGA.
When has he ever...
The PGA has done jack for you. Okay, the Saudis wanted to pay you billions of dollars.
Well, how are the TV ratings?
You're their puppet.
How are the TV ratings
for
the Liv? Nobody can.
And by the way, I'm an American, and I cheer for Bryson DeChambeau to win the U.S. Open.
He's annoying.
So, get on your private jet, skip out on the press conference, and head back to South Florida to avoid the tough questions of you choking like a dog, Rory.
Yeah.
Get the heck out of here.
Well, yeah, I agree with that. It was lame that he left. So I agree with you there.
See ya.
All right, see you, Randy.
Sport Hole.
Sports.
First and 10 at the 21. Stone, shoulder fake, tries to climb the pocket, does. Has the receiver. What a play by Preston Stone. Touchdown.
Sporty, SMU is our team of the week to preview. What do you think of the Mustangs this year? They got BYU in the non-conference.
What in the Sam heck is going on with Sambo there, Larry? Do you have any idea?
No.
SMU, pony up. Speaking of DeChambeau, we're talking about SMU football on our... we're going to break down about a team a day heading into the college football season. We know SMU plays BYU in the non-conference schedule. SMU is interesting because... First of all, is the ACC going to fold in like 2 months, like the UAC? I don't know. But SMU is going to be in the ACC. It's going to be harder for them. But if you look at Rhett Lashley, who's been there 2 years, he's a Gus Malzahn acolyte. Acolyte? Is that the right word? Look that up, will you, Larry?
Yes.
He comes from the Gus Malzahn tree of coaches. Took him over a couple years ago, did okay his first year, did great last year, won 10-plus games. And he plays in the American Conference, so he's beating Tulsa and all these crappy programs. SMU hasn't won a big game against a quality opponent since they beat TCU back in 2021. So there's some strength of schedule, winning against good teams, questionability about SMU. Now, I know BYU isn't going to be a great team this year. And so SMU is going to be favored in that game. But the reason they should be favored is because they have one of the best quarterbacks in the country, probably the best group of five quarterback in the country, Preston Stone, back this year. 3,600 yards, 30 touchdowns, 7 interceptions last year, led them to a great year in this Lashley system. So my question is, how many teams this year is BYU going to face? where the other team doesn't have a better quarterback than them. Just looking at the non-conference, you've got SIU, you'll have a better quarterback than them. You've got Wyoming, who doesn't have the Peasley kid anymore. They've got this Kubota kid from Snow College, might be their starter. Kid that didn't play at Snow, played a little bit last year, looked okay. Maybe Wyoming, but you go through the Big 12, it's going to be hard in the quarterback matchup to say BYU has a better quarterback than any of these people, and they don't when it comes to SMU. Here's what's interesting about Stone is, after having such a tremendous year last year, statistically and win-loss-wise, how the heck is he still at SMU? With the quarterback NIL market the way it is, when you're a group of five guy, you have a year like that, you're getting the heck out of Dallas-Fort Worth and going and playing in the Big 12 or in the Big 10 or anywhere. This speaks to SMU's NIL collective for paying. He's got to be making a lot of money to stay at SMU because I'm sure he was offered a lot on the black market in the NIL. So we always hear about SMU, sleeping giant, big market, huge rich alumni, oil rich, and all that stuff. Keeping Stone is an indicator that that is the case and that they do have a future. And maybe if they go to the ACC, that'll awaken their boosters and their alumni to say, okay, we're actually playing people we've heard of before. Let's infuse this program with money, especially if we can get Lashley to stay and not book for a bigger job. Now, if he wins, you know, 10 games again this year, he's gone. He's going to leave unless they can pay him a ton of money. He's an SEC guy. He wants to get to big-time football. So he'll book it from SMU, especially with the precarious nature that the ACC is still in. Right, Larry?
Yes.
Oh, I also wanted to talk about here briefly, Larry. So, Brett Yormark is considering selling the naming rights to the Big 12. And it could be like the All-State 12 Conference. Which, to me, is a sign. And I love Yormark, and I love how he hustles, and I love how he comes into the Big 12 and says, look, we're way behind. We've got to compete with the SEC and the Big Ten. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to change all of our TV rights. We're going to ink this deal before the Pac-12. We're going to pillage the Pac-12. We're going to pillage the Pac-12. We're going to bring these programs in. We're going to do all this creative stuff to generate money and sales and stuff like that. And now, potentially, selling the rights of the naming of the conference to be the All-State 12. I don't know how I feel about that, Larry. To me, it's a sign of complete desperation. It's like when a company is having a going out of business clearance sale, they're selling their pens and their paper clips and stuff. This is what that kind of seems like. But the Big 12 needs a guy who's going to hustle and is going to sell the pens and the paper clips for revenue so they can compete with the Big 2. And the Big 12 is going away probably soon, but I like that he's going down swinging with crap like this. So I don't have a problem with selling the naming rights to the conference, even though it's tacky. Get the money. See what you can do. Your goal is to get as many teams in the college football playoff as you can over the next few years while you have this incredible access to the playoff. You're not going to have this forever. These little teams like Houston, UCF, and heck, Iowa State, Kansas, Utah, BYU, you have incredible access to the playoff that I can't imagine lasting very long. So make hay while the sun shines, right, Larry?
Yes.
And I love Yormark. He hustles. All right, thank you, Lawrence.
Letter to the Sport Hole. You can write to the Sport Hole at 93776.
All right, Letter to the Sport Hole is brought to you by Advanced Window Products. Check out Advanced Window Products. Since 1986, they've been serving the state of Utah with the best, highest efficiency windows available. If you want to save on your energy bill this hot summer in southern Utah, Advanced Window Products can help you save. And because it's a locally owned window and door manufacturing company that sells direct to the public, There's no third-party markups. So they pass the savings on to you. You save big on the price of the windows. You save big on your utility bill this summer. With advanced window products, there's financing available, a lifetime warranty, all sorts of colors and designs, any window shape you want, they'll make it for you. It's an amazing operation. I was up there a few weeks ago at the warehouse. Financing's available. Buy local. Support the local economy. Visit advancedwindows.com. All right, this letter is from Belva. I think this is our first letter from Belva. You can write us anytime at 750 West Ridgeview Drive. Dear Sport Hole, did you see that amazing skateboarder do back-to-back-to-back 900s over the weekend? I know you're not a big X Games fan or extreme sports fan, but wondering if you saw it. Yes, I did. Here it is.
Going to be a big factor, though. Who is making most of their runs? Even if they're repeating them, because right now we've seen a lot of bails.
All right, Emma.
Are we going 3 900s right now? One.
He's like, yeah. Here's my best trick.
Two.
Is that 1800?
He's got it. He's got it.
Ah! Here we go. History in the making.
Three-peat.
And body burial.
He's got to be a little dizzy.
That, he's trying to unwind with the front.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Back.
Fantastic. Thank you, Belva. That was Tony Hawk there in the broadcast booth. That probably should have been our Gus Johnson Award winner. There's two types of skateboarders. The posers that do it to kind of get girls and to be cool. And then there's guys that actually do the real tricks and stuff. I used to work at a juvenile detention center up in Logan, and all the kids were skateboarders. And I gained a new respect for skateboarding because we would go, we'd leave the dorms where they were locked down most of the day. We'd go out onto the blacktop, and they would all have their boards. And they all sucked. They were all terrible. But they would just do the good ones. Would take their board, and they would do the same little kickflip trick like 1,000 times in a row. And they would just fail at it every single time. It wouldn't land right. They wouldn't land on it. They'd fall over. They'd hit their elbow. They'd do it again. And then it wouldn't work. And they'd do it for like an hour the whole time we were out there. And it wouldn't work once. They wouldn't do it right one time. And then the next day they'd come out, the good ones. And they would just do that again and again and again and again forever. And finally, maybe, I don't know how long it takes, they get this little ollie kick, whatever, flip thing where they land it right. I gained new respect because that's not fun to do. Like, if you suck at pickleball, it's still fun to go out and play it. Skateboarding, that's not fun to fail that many times. You're not getting any adrenaline. You're not getting any thrill from doing that practice. So to get good at skateboarding is a monotonous, painful task. And so I have respect for the guys who are real skateboarders who can do all that stuff. The guys that are doing it just so that they can wear the Ramones shirt and, you know, they're vaping and they're hanging out and doing whatever. Those guys can kiss off because they're just posers. But the ones that actually put in the time and the sweat equity and the blood, sweat, and tears to become good at skateboarding, that's, you know, we applaud those guys, Larry. And this kid is obviously one of them. He's 9 years old. Ima Kawakami from Kobe, Japan, did 3 900s in a row. Now, Tony Hawk, when he did 1 900, like a decade and a half ago, was the biggest deal in the world. Nobody had ever done it. This kid's 9 years old, and he does them in his sleep. I don't know if it's easier for a kid because their body's smaller or something, but he was incredible, and he deserves our praise. Well, thank you. Very good, Belva. Appreciate you.
Working on my Jack Nicholson.
Sport Hall Weekend Movie Rack.
You can't handle the truth.
Weekend Movie Rec is brought to you by Balance of Nature. Check out balanceofnature.com. That's real fruit, real veggies in a capsule at balanceofnature.com and use promo code TOWNSQUARE to get a discount on your first order. What do we got, Larry?
Throwing right side, and it's caught. Intercepted. Intercepted by Sean Taylor in the end zone. Bringing it up the left side, and he's still moving and taken down at his own 28-yard
line. We got the ball back.
The ball fumbled at the end of the play.
We got it back.
Okay, Youngstown boys, another 30 for 30. I watched like 5 30 for 30s this weekend. I hadn't seen, for some reason, I hadn't seen Youngstown boys with Maurice Claret and Jim Tressel. 2001 Ohio State Buckeyes. I forgot how sad the Maurice Claret saga was. Freshman, super duper star, takes Ohio State to the national title, wins the national title, makes that play you just played one of the best plays in championship history. Krenzel throws a pick. Claret chases down Sean Taylor, rips the ball away from him to get it back for the Buckeyes. One of the biggest upsets of my young life, Larry. Do you remember that game?
Yes.
That Miami team was the best college football talent-wise team ever. The year before, they had just killed Nebraska by a million points. And they had, like, every player on that team was an NFL player. And then the Buckeyes with Craig Krenzel and Maurice Claret go and win it the next year. So that was great. They set up the documentary to show that Claret was completely screwed over by Ohio State, betrayed by Tressel and the athletic director. And it's super sad because then he can't play football for two more years. Ohio State suspends him. He wants to go to the NFL. The NFL doesn't want him. He needs to be out of high school for 3 years. And so he just loses it. Gets fat, drugs, alcohol. Gets a chance with the Broncos when he's eligible, but he's just terrible. Has a horrible combine. So it's a good spoiler alert, by the way, Larry. Have you seen it?
No.
Well, there's more than that, so, you know, you can still go watch it. But I want to say we need to go do some more research because what it basically does is put all the blame on, like all these documentaries do, victimizing Claret 100%, putting all the blame on Ohio State. I bet if we went back and looked at the details of it more, we'd find that he was more culpable and responsible for the discipline that was dished out. Because the documentary makes it seem like he was complete. He did couple minor things and they just hammered him way harsh. So we got to look into that a little bit more, Larry. It was great. Loved it. It's amazing how every 30 for 30 is pretty good. All right. Judas Priest. Go ahead, Larry.
I'm the one that got it done and did a great job.
All right, we got to hurry here. Handyman is brought to you by Bucks Ace Hardware. Check out Bucks' three Southern Utah locations. And right now, building a 40,000-square-foot Bucks Ace Hardware out to Hurricane. It's going to be amazing. Proud sponsor of local sports. Do we have time for this, Larry?
Yes.
Okay, so we were talking about week zero last week and how we can make it better in FCS. We need pay games. We also need interconference battles, Big Ten versus SEC. Here's another thing we could do, Larry, to kind of fix up week zero. And this could go for college basketball, too. We need to start scheduling college football and college basketball like boxing or the UFC does, which is, we want to see showdowns, or like the WWE. We want to market these showdowns, these revenge games. We want to bring eyeballs to these early games that are usually kind of preseason matchups. We want to stir up the controversy and stir up the drama a little bit more. I know college sports schedules are determined years in advance. We got to change that because I would have a showdown week zero type thing, and maybe we can do this a little bit further down the road when it's a super league with 70 teams. But I want to see games like Washington versus Alabama, Kalen DeBoer versus his old team, Washington. All these coaches that betray their old programs, I want to see it. I want to see Utah State playing all of these. I want to see them play Washington next year in some sort of a spite tournament. We want spite tournaments. You see what I'm saying, Larry?
Yes.
UW versus Arizona in football. Jed Fish leaves Arizona. I want to see that matchup, even though they're not in the same conference anymore. I want to see Oklahoma take on Oregon because Dylan Gabriel leaves Oklahoma to go play quarterback at Oregon. I want to see that matchup. I want to see Kentucky and Mark Pope play BYU this year. This year, make an adjustment to the schedule. Have a basketball, it's easier because there's all these meaningless preseason tournaments. Make a spite tournament. Schedule the games now. I want to see Pope versus BYU. I want to see Pope versus Calipari. I want to see Arkansas versus Kentucky. I guess we will see that because they're the same conference. So I guess the future of college sports, as things change and the conferences change and divisions, we need to have a focus on, and when TV money means everything, we need to have a week, a challenge week, with nothing but showdown matchups. We already have a rivalry week, though. That won't change. I'm just talking about a spike week, Clary. You like it?
Yes.
All right. Let's wrap it up.
Ladies and gentlemen, this week's Gus Johnson Award goes to...
That's confusing, Larry, right?
Yes.
There was no announcers. Okay, so that is Vermont state championship baseball game, Mount Abraham, bases loaded, bottom of the last inning, tie ball game, batter walks. That's what you heard. Everybody's flipping out. Now, the Gus Johnson Award goes to the dad in the stands who's yelling at the kid who just walked, walk off, walk. He just walked. The runner from third is going to score. The game is over. The batter doesn't go to first base. He starts flexing. He starts bat flipping. He starts doing a jig. His other teammates come out and party with him. And the dad in the stands is saying, touch first base. And the third base coach realizes and starts running over towards him. And there's this huge dog pile. He's trying to dig out the kid and say, hey, you idiot, you got to go touch first. We're going to, you know, they're going to take away the state championship from us. Well, the umpire does. He calls him out. And so you blame the kid. You blame the coaches for not doing it. But you also blame, I don't know what side I am on this, because part of me is just like, okay, the third base coach realizes it, goes and grabs the kid. The kid then runs down to first base. The umpire says it's too late. He's already out. And I want to blame the stickler umpire for literally ruining this kid's life, because this kid's life is over. But then I want to blame the idiot kid. But then you got to blame the idiot coaches for not understanding he's got to go touch first base and getting caught up in the moment. But I want to reward the dad for being the only one apparently in the stadium yelling, go touch first base. So wherever that dad is, congratulations. You got $10. Poo-poo chicken island grinds. We have it for you here in the studio. Quick break. Back with Marvin.